And sometimes, I mean, very rarely, but there's sometimes interference. So if you could power off your phone,
I just did.
Oh, good, good. But not just something completely power off.
Yes,
power off. Welcome, everybody, to the Martin E. Segal Theater Center here at the Graduate Center CUNY, and kudos and thank you for coming out on a tough, cold April evening or night. We had many more reservations, but this weather, and I personally got four or five mails, this weather is not cooperating, and as Keith early pointed out, once you also write live streaming, you know, and you have to think, do I get on the subway?
So I just
get
home
the umbrella, walk through the rain, and bear the snowstorm that might be coming tonight, you know. So, but anyway, as no, they said it might be snowing tonight. Yes.
No.
Might also be here. And but we have the real followers here with us. So everybody came, and these are real fans, and like in the good old punk days, which I liked very much. These bands said, we don't want to have 2 million idiots following us. We want to have 100 or 1,000 real fans and real good ones. And I think you really, whoever is here, you know, really cares about what this evening is all about. I'm Frank Henschke, the director of programs at the Segal Center, and we bridge academia and professional theater, international and American theater. And this is, I think, our third or fourth evening we collaborate together. And I think the work of the new Black Fest is truly inspiring. It's amazing. And it is our honor, you know, to host something. I had something else in mind when we talked, but Keith said, you know, the revolutionary writing, a town hall meeting project is something that, you know, would be the right thing to do at the time we live in now, in the moment. So I think he was right, and he will tell us a little bit more. If you have a cell phone, take it out right now for a moment and make sure it's off. I'll do the same. It should say ring or off, sound off, whatever it is.
Power off.
Power off, and the format will be four short readings, and the players will talk a bit with Keith, and then there will be an open discussion and a small reception afterwards. So again, thank you for coming, and Keith, maybe some words about you, your work, and about the evening.
Yes. Thank you, Frank, and the Segal Theater. I'm Keith Josef Adkins, the artistic director of the New Black Fest. Thanks, you guys, for being here tonight on this cold, rainy, spring, summer, winter night. Climate change is a very real thing. I'm very excited for tonight. When Frank asked me to collaborate again around an event, and I thought revolutionary writing would be the very perfect thing to discuss in 2016. With all this happening in the world, from economics to race to policing to gender equity to economic equity, it's time to talk about revolution and what that means in 2016, as opposed to what it looked like 30 or 40 years ago, or maybe it is the same thing. And I was really curious about bringing together four different people who I have a lot of admiration for, who I feel are really writing urgent, revolutionary things. They may not consider that themselves to be revolutionary writers, but I certainly consider themselves to be revolutionary writers. Lenelle Moïse, Liza Jessie Peterson, Nsangou Njikam, and Dennis Allen II. They all will be reading tonight four excerpts of pieces they're working on or pieces that have already been produced. And then after that, I will join them in a conversation that will last about 20, 25 minutes. And then we will all engage you in that conversation around what revolutionary writing looks like in 2016. I'm going to bring to the stage Lenelle Moïse, Dennis Allen II, Liza Jessie Peterson, and Nsangou Njikam.
Hi, everybody. I'm Lenelle Moïse. How you doing?
Good.
I can see you. You can see me. I can hear you. You can hear me. When I say click, you say clack. Click.
Clack.
Click.
Clack.
When I say nu, you say la. Nu.
La.
That means we're here. Nu.
La.
Nu.
La.
Remember Noah. You have to understand, it was so hot. Sand as far as the eye could see. Sand in teeth. A sealess life. Every step, a sinking, a scratch. Every storm, more sand. No sweat when we danced. Pure salt in our lovemaking. I tried to spit once. It came out like a whistle. My first period, curry powder. Old wives spoke of tears. We thought they were senile. Laughter was our wettest thing. Say that with me. Laughter was.
Laughter was.
Our wettest thing.
Thing.
We prayed often to no one. We believed in music, dry palms clapping, dust on ankle bracelets. We threw tabla and daf, caught spirit and sagat, a blaring life, the wailing of cesarean births. Widows' eyes wept wind. Even our tongues were tanned. Something sun-dried in every recipe. Rays were babies' first words. You have to understand, we forgot how to be thirsty. Mud by then was primitive, splashing the stuff of legend. Only giddiness quenched us. We were dizzy all the time, in the world all the time. Then we heard him grumbling to himself, something about 40, something about a flood. Clad in sheep's wool, he reeked of wolf shit, something about monogamy, something about shelter. I thought, this must be heat stroke. I thought, the brain of a 600-year-old. I thought, he is a conceptual artist, the arc an installation. His masterpiece took years, took trees, got bigger. He was our favorite dirty joke, beloved schizophrenic neighbor. Then he started preaching. Then he kidnapped pigs, mosquitoes, doves, things that wanted to eat each other, stuffed onto the same boat. We threw our heads back. We smacked ashy knees. We mooned him through hot stones. We streaked, whistled in his face, kicked the baking ship. Laughter was our thunder thing. The lucky ones died laughing. For centuries, he warned us, condescending motherfucker, foaming at the mouth, sweat dripping from his beard. Condensation. How did we miss it? I have no words for the first drop, cooling the cheek. Grandfathers raised their arms, lightning made the children leap. Sizzle gave way to drizzle. Humidity taught humility. We opened our mouths, swallowing everything. The clouds begat clouds, began to bite us back. Panic soaked our slouching spines. The instruments drowned first. We played them sopping out of tune. Denial gave way to rivers. I fell into a puddle, my first shiver. The shock of cold water made me orgasm. So all the times before had been dry heave. So this was morning. This was mikvah, the sky from blue to za'atar hail. We choked, God's vomit filled our lungs. Apologies, belly flopped, reaching went out of reach. We ran from high desert to highest mountain, to whirlpool of coral grief. If Noah had been merciful, he would have taught us how to swim. Instead, he saved two mice, muttered prayers, shut the door. The best belly dancers became mermaids. The dinosaurs learned to fly. I never saw a rainbow, our gravestones, coral reef. So that's Remember Noah. And this collection is Haiti Glass. I'm currently working on a solo performance called Where There Are Voices, based on this book of poems. It's, you know, I believe in, you know, how poetry can also be gesture, can also be song. And, you know, the collection is about desire and disaster and death-defying love. And so I'm gonna end with this other poem, since we are black artists talking about a black artist. This is another disaster, another song of love. Self-portrait as a heel, your dreadlock crown, your square teeth of America, O grimace of Port-au-Prince, O tags on helmet, door you found, you au jardin, barefoot in bum-rushed studio, so bebop boxer brave, so Basquiat, a canvas on corruption, an ancient issue magic, you mocked Van Gogh for breakfast, skipped lunch to piss with Warhol, kicked for screamers, kinged the sons of slaves. You black, you fight, you gray, play clarinet, you could not play clear as Cassius Clay, disheveled crown. You punk rock auction block, mishap, randy rap, art world spit, misfit. You profit by design, free for fee, so radical, oh feeler, oh sensitive, pensive ghoul, you uptight bass, upright animal, minimalism, middle fingered, namer of same old shit. Oh, $1 million it boy, your flippant brush, your brush with death. You rode his old white bones, golden crown, majestic Mona Lisa scribble, smile, you Charlie, Chaplin, Parker, Park Bench Avenue, new wave, new dare, new devil divine in details, you colored show, museum bust, you rust, you anxious bite, obnoxious liberals not, you let them in, X'd them out, lived off X's, sucked their collars como chicken, then heroin for dinner, then island eyes, then grief for sale, a war subliminal, a subway token, oh broken crown, oh high art fears, oh hunter's tears, oh cursing clown, low urban game, colonial woe, Cristobal colonoscopy exhibit, you fury of Puerto Rico, you fort, your art for soup, you set that on fire, paint splattered Armani suit, you exposed root, brilliant family tree, bleeding fallen leaf, you left us high on glyphs, chest exhumed, you vehicular treasure, exhausted heart on walls, oh winged, oh worn, oh hiccup warning, oh earthling, trophy, knife, woe, life, trophonius, woe, error, yo, hero, so overdose, so clever man, a dozen in a zillion, you flag stuck in knees, you juice for joints of jumpers, we leap because you left. I weep. We never met.
I just need to look that. Try to digest that for a second. I'm going to read an excerpt from a play I wrote called When We Wake Up Dead. And to give you a setup so that we have some context. So there are twins, fraternal twins, Bryant and James. They're from New York. They're visiting their aunt, cousin, and uncle who is dying of cancer in Mississippi. They just traveled, just got on the plane, just got into the house, and they found their cousin, Emery, save him from hanging himself. And as they're trying to figure out what to do, Aunt Cheryl comes home. They cover up the hanging, and Aunt Cheryl leaves again. So this is the first time that the cousins interact with each other after they found him hanging. So I'm going to play three characters. It's the first time for everything. And I'll try to make sure that you guys can follow who's who. So we have Emery, who's the younger cousin, and then we have Bryant and James, who are the twins. Cheryl exits. The screen door cries and slams. A minute. The sound of the vehicle's engine and tires on the gravel road. Emery starts putting the groceries away. Emery. Hi, y'all. Bryant. Hey, y'all. Hey, that's what you say? Is hey, that's what you say? Emery. You like hi better? Bryant. Nigga, is you crazy? James. You have to ask that? Emery, could you help me put these away, please? Bryant helps Emery. James watches. Em, my dude, I love you like my little brother. You know that. Why are you trying to off yourself? Are you off your meds? James, more like off his rocker. Bryant, yo, are you going to help us? James, nope. James walks to the back room to get his bags. Emery, James is the same I see. Bryant, yeah, well, he's James. Hey. You stop taking your medication? Emery, no. Bryant, are you lying? I ain't lying. So what's good, man? Nothing. You sad about your pops? Daddy's been dying a long time now. What's that mean? I'm fine, cuz. Don't give me fine. You are not fine. Fine is not bungee jumping with your neck. As a matter of fact, if you look up fine in the dictionary, it's the opposite of bungee jumping with your neck. James enters. Leave him alone, Bryant. What, like you tried to? James, Bubba obviously has his reasons. You badgering him won't make things magically better. Emery finishes with the groceries and walks to the back room. Move his stuff to his parents' room. Bryant. Yo, why are you so cold-hearted? James, you got all the warm and fuzzy jeans. I'm serious, yo. You stay walking around like you don't give a fuck, but I know you do. I'm not cold-hearted, I'm logical. Logic, you should try it sometime. Oh, logic, you should try it sometime. Yeah, like not carrying 100 bags at once. Yo, if you would have helped me instead of standing there like a worthless doorman, two trips, that would have been logical, making two trips. Why would I can make it in one? It's hot as hell, don't nobody want to go back and forth outside in the sun? Yo, you are borderline retarded, and you're the always sociopath. Just gonna let your little cousin hang himself. Rational thought, logic, something your monkey ass is missing. Bryant, baby Dama over here. I'm gonna start calling you baby Dama. I'm not crazy. Yo, next thing you know, you're gonna start eating motherfuckers and putting half-eat asses in the fridge. Yo, I'm not crazy, you dumb shit. I ain't put the rope around his neck. Then I gotta explain to the cops why there's frozen half-asses in the crib. Be on the news like the neighbors like, oh, he was such a good kid. I would have never thought. Everybody's crazy, not me. I just know you can't save everybody. And you're black, so the whole community gonna be pissed because only crazy white folk do that shit, eating asses. And niggas gonna look at me like I'm funny because we twins. And my sex life is gonna go down the tubes because chicks are gonna look at me like I'm your nutty ass. I'm not crazy. He's crazy. Him. He's the one on drugs, trying to kill himself every other month. One day he's fine, next day his unstable ass is on a bridge somewhere. Crazy, worthless nigga. Emery. I miss you too, Jay. Emery exits. Screen door cries and slams. Bryant, hashtag my brother is an asshole. Shut up. Yo, go apologize. What for? Come on. It wasn't even directed at him, man. I was just mad at your annoying ass. Bryant, don't tell me. James, whatever. A moment. The screen door cries out. James exit. The door slams. Bryant, damn, it's hot.
I'm Liza Jessie Peterson, and I'm going to be reading an excerpt from my multimedia one-woman show entitled The Peculiar Patriot. And it takes place inside of a women's prison facility, and the protagonist, Betsy LaPonda Ross, is visiting her best friend, so you're eavesdropping in on the conversation between two women on the visiting room floor in a prison. But Pablo, girl, he be dropping mad politics. We be having deep conversations. He be getting heated. He mad passionate, y'all. Mm-hmm. I like his take on things. It's definitely a war, all right. Prisons are jumping off the damn hook like Jiffy, providing the main source of economy for these upstate trailer park, windmill, rural, dairy white communities, all while politicians are filling their constituency bellies with nigga snacks. We are a nutritional treat. The screen projects an animated video of little brown gingerbread men riding on a conveyor belt, being rolled into a big box of cereal that says, nigga snacks, they're financially nutritious. Video screen then reads the statistics of stop and frisk, the percentage of New York State prisons in rural areas, and the percentage of inmates of color in these prisons. Girl, as soon as a prison is built, it provides steady year-round employment. Not to mention all the diners and the rest stops that's making more money because you got more people coming upstate to visit their loved ones. Plus, girl, the people are living in these rural, running the red, white communities wasn't earning no real substantial income until the prison got built. Now, child, Billy Bob, Mary Jo, Jimmy Ray, they all now government employees earning a very nice coin, complete with pensions, benefits, and all that nice fluffy shit. Where there was once just a country dirt road, is now a newly constructed strip mall to meet the demand of the entire community, which has miraculously increased their earning power thanks to the prison. The whole community gets a facelift. And girl, it is also fascinating to note that government money for districts is based on the number of people living in these districts. Girl, these underpopulated rural white towns, they get to count the number of inmates in their census. So on paper, it looks like they have more residents than they actually do. Therefore they get more money from the state to build their healthcare clinics, community centers, playgrounds, basketball courts, and stuff like that. Our nigga snack numbers help all these rural white towns get that money, but it don't benefit our neighborhoods where the niggas come from. So while the yee-haws is celebrating, this orchestrated nigga dragnet demolition strategy leaves our community tore up from the floor up. Families broken up, money going to these rural towns, and our voting power shrinks. Cause Busta girl, when you come home, you won't be working. And if you're working, you know you won't be paying Uncle Sam his taxes, cause you know that gangster take his coin straight off the top. Okay, so now, cause you probably gonna be on parole for a minute, means you're not gonna be able to vote. But because you're working, you're still paying taxes. So that's taxation without representation. That's why they come looking for us, stopping and frisking us. Girl, we straight cash money crops. And some of these towns have more inmates than residents. Can you imagine? More inmates than residents. Crime does pay for certain people and certain communities. Yeah. This war on drugs is a trip. You know I be going in. When I showed Pablo my little pie chart I made with all my statistics, girl, he was so impressed. Why did he take out a piece of paper and a pen and start taking some notes? I said, ooh, Pablo. I'm feeling you feeling me. When I told him that in New York State, not the city, but the entire state, the majority of drug dealers is white. But out of all the drug offenders locked up in New York State prison, something like 98% is black and Latino. Girl, they ain't doing more to crime, but we the ones sitting up here doing the time. Chad, when I started kicking my funky bobo, you could have fried an egg on Poppy's head and boiled some soup. He was so mad. See there? That's that bullshit. See, that's what I'm talking about. All right, so now the way you breaking it down, statistics. Mathematically, you know what I'm saying? I'm just a pawn in the main criminal's war strategy. Yo, ma, you ain't really saying nothing new. Because these white motherfuckers been playing dirty, though. You know the Constitution says that slavery is still illegal except
for punishment of a crime. You peep the motherfucking loophole, mommy, except for punishment of a crime. So if you commit a crime, then you become a legal slave. Yeah, the okie doke. Well, think about it, ma. Back in slavery time, a nigga had to work for free. He ain't have no say in the matter. That was it. Law. White motherfuckers taking up for all that free labor for 100 of years. No payroll, just profit. Now that's a hustler's dream, baby. But when slavery ended, a nigga could sit down and relax, try to get his mind right. He ain't have to do shit for the white man. So what the cracker do, ma? They made laws making it a crime to not have a job. Crazy shit like you can get arrested for laughing or looking them in the eye, anything a cracker said you did. The black codes, yeah, like that real devil type shit. So now all of a sudden, the black man is getting locked up feverishly, you heard? The motherfucker slave master, he ain't got no more slaves, but now he can get him some convicts and make him do slave work for free, legally. Same nigga, same job, same zero pay, just a different title. Yeah, mommy, you ain't know about that. Yeah, I be beating up a lot of deep informative shit, you know what I'm saying? I don't read them hood drama books. My life is more fascinating anyway, you heard? I need to write a book. I seek knowledge. I'm a different type of dude like that. Yeah, so now, look at the shit today. Mad niggas is locked up. We convicted legal slaves. These ain't nothing but old war games, mommy. I got to give it to the white man, though. He mad strategic with his shit. War on drugs is really ain't nothing but a war on me. So technically, that makes me a POWOD. I'm a prisoner of the war on drugs. So where's my flag? Where's my motherfucking flag? Word up.
Second, everybody is at home, at dinner, at the club, watching television, and you're waiting for the next non-indictment of a police officer who's killed a 10-year-old young black girl who was playing hide-and-go-seek, and she was mistaken for an adult. And imagine you're waiting, and you've been waiting for weeks with bated breath to hear that the officer will be indicted. And you're eating, and you're watching television, and you're at the club dancing. And finally, the DA comes out and says the officer will not be indicted on any charges. Again, imagine. Except imagine this time, as soon as that announcement is made, the screen goes blue and a black silhouette shows up. And a voice covered by voice altering technology says this. Do not attempt to adjust your screens. This is not an error. My name is Khalif. And I speak directly to the African American community tonight. Just moments ago, you waited with bated breath on justice. And like so many times before, justice has eluded you. Another child has died by the hands of a system. Yes, a system. The same system that killed Malcolm and King. The same system that holds men and women behind iron bars. The same system that said you were subhuman, inferior, and only meant for slavery. This system has yet again proven it never has and never will care about your life, except as it pertains to its needs. You are not free here. You never have been free. What you called freedom was merely the crumbs of access, and you suffered greatly for those crumbs. So what do you say now that a young girl's life has no meaning? That Skittles and music, wallets and toys are seen as threats? That your very existence incites fear? What will you do? Protest? Riot? Petition? No. Those are foolish acts. Tonight, we present a true solution. My organization is called The Community, and they have spent the past several years in talks with 9 African nations. These nations have secretly agreed to grant you political refuge in their countries under the laws created by the United Nations. We have set up transportation to the continent to any one of these 9 nations for any citizen of African descent who wishes to leave America. These nations are rich in resources. Their societies are ready to welcome you with open arms, and your skin will become your birthright and privilege and not your burden. Imagine having your own land. Imagine building your own business in a land where your skills are rewarded. You don't belong here. You don't need American money or values to achieve life, liberty, and happiness. America has been your abusive lover, and now it's time for a breakup. In the next few days, we will release details to those interested in leaving. I urge you, children of Africa, consider what is said here tonight. Consider the writing on the walls. Which would you rather have? Access or freedom? Your very life may depend on this choice. We await your answer.
Thank you all so much. Another round of applause for these amazing writers / performers. We're going to be setting up for the talk back pretty quickly here. I will move the music stand to get us started. Can everyone hear me pretty clearly and accurately?
Yes.
Thank you all for being here. Again, you guys, I love you. And for those of you who do not know, or just need a reminder, tonight's conversation is about what revolution looks like in 2016. And I want to just sort of start off by reading the definition of revolution. It's from the Latin word revolutio, which means turnaround. So speaking of turnaround, I want to ask each one of you to speak a little bit about what you just read, and how within that is your desire to turn around your world, turn around our world. In other words, what does revolution mean to you in 2016? We'll start there.
For me,
For me, revolution means the end of racism, white supremacy. And so in my work, which it's a love story, even though it addresses the prison industrial complex. I am a firm believer that black love is kryptonite for white supremacy. So when we as a community, as a people, as a culture begin to really embrace who we are and love each other and love ourselves to the highest heights, I think, and remembering who we are and, you know, acknowledging who we are in the face of, you know, all this insurmountable and a continual campaign to dehumanize us and destroy us, I think that for me is revolution. We've seen, spurts of it in all of the, and throughout time since we've been here, the civil rights movement, you know, the Black Arts Movement, the Black Panther Movement, we've seen spurts. So we just have to continue, I think that that loving of ourselves, and not that we don't love other people, but we have to heal and love ourselves first, because we've been so injured and so wounded. And for me, that once that happens, that'll be the, I think, beginnings of the crumblings of this, not beginnings, but I think the final maybe nail in the coffin of white racism, white supremacy.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I can call names. Dennis.
I knew you were about to call me. So my play, When We Wake Up Dead, deals with a few issues. One of them being mental illness. One of them being, and most of my plays right now deal with untreated trauma and secrets and how that gets perpetuated, specifically in the black community. And so I've been thinking about this, Keith, because I figured you were going to ask us something about revolution.
Being that's what the title of the evening.
Yeah. It was a good clue. So I started thinking about, really, when I think about revolution, I think about change, and then I went into self. And I thought, okay, what brought about change in myself? What are the moments that allowed me to look at myself and say, oh, I need to change? And it's just that. It's when I was able to see myself, whether it was see myself in someone else or someone was able to reflect that to me in terms of what my behavior was reflecting. And I think in my work, it's important that I show how we are. And images matter. And we don't get images from our voices. We tend to get images that are filtered through what has been deemed the white gaze. And we don't get to tell our own stories, whether that's because of access or everything else that comes into play. So as an artist and as a person who loves black people and loves everything about blackness here in America, I think it's my duty to show where we are. Because if we don't know where we are, we can't heal. It's impossible. It is impossible. If we don't acknowledge the pain that we are suffering right now, it's impossible to heal. So that's what When We Wake Up Dead means to me. I think that's what revolution is. It's just to hold up the mirror and allow us to see ourselves. And then once you see yourself, you can then make the decision if you want to change or not. Because you can't change anybody. This is an impossible thing to do. But you can, if you see yourself, you can make that decision if you see it.
You know, what's interesting, back in the green room here at the Segal's green room, we were having a conversation. Lenelle actually asked me what revolution meant to me. And I was sort of going through each writer and just sort of explaining to them why I feel they are revolutionary. And for Dennis, you know, I was saying that, you know, over the years I've sort of observed your writing, your evolution as a writer, and you seem to continue, you seem to visit territory around abuse, untreated trauma. And in particular, your most recent play, When We Wake Up Dead, was done at Brooklyn College. It deals specifically with mental health and the cycle of not acknowledging its existence or sort of trying to dismiss its existence and not giving it its full attention and therefore its medicine. And so I just want you to speak a little bit more about what reason for you, Dennis, is it important for you to continue to visit these territories in your writing? Because it's not random. And I'm not asking you to get personal. I'm just saying, like, you know, is mental health an issue that you feel is a revolutionary issue that needs to be addressed in our community?
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah, so there's the dismissal that we do across the board when it comes to mental health issues. And really the only time we talk about it is when there's a mass shooting, right? That's the only time we really say anything about mental health, when there's a mass shooting, so that we can dismiss it and not really talk about guns or whatever we don't want to really talk about. And we say it's an issue, but we don't really address it. We just talk about, oh, we need help with mental health issues. Personally, in terms of mental health, actually, what's interesting is, so you know, my mother is, I know Keith knows, but my mother is a therapist by trade. So I always kind of grew up around and was bred in, you know, seeing people as fully human and having language and having the privilege of language when it comes to emotional health. And my mother, actually, I come from a family of secrets. So my mother, when she was 30 and I was about 5 years old, learned that the father that she grew up with was not really her father. And not only that, but the man that she learned was her father, when he finally came forward and said, "I'm your father, you need to know this," he said that because he was dying of heart disease at the time. What also came up in my mother at the time was remembrance of the man she thought was her father abusing her as a child, sexually abusing her, right? So for 30 years, she thought a man who was her father. She suppressed the memories, and they all came up when her real father came into the fold. And she has been, because when you're a therapist, she was a social worker, you have to go through therapy. So she has had the opportunity and the privilege to go through therapy. So the reason that she's as well as she is now is because she went through that therapy. But most of us don't have that. We don't have language, we don't have the time, we don't have the privilege, we don't put in the effort. And because of that, things get perpetuated. Secrets, pain, and we're literally killing ourselves from the inside. So when it comes to mental health, it's important for me because we're not talking about the things we should be talking about. We're not talking about the self-care that we should be implementing. And because of that, we're dying. We're dying as a people, we're dying as a society, and it's until we face that, personally, that I feel like we need to heal. So that's why I write what I write.
Lenelle?
Well, I'm thinking about this notion of turning back and how there's something about the word revolution that takes us away from that root definition. There's something about momentum and moving ahead and eyes on the prize and marching forward. And I think it's really important in my work to take a look back. You're sort of ready to pack your bags and go to the next moment. But then I'm interested in unpacking the baggage. You know, and when I look inside of that baggage that I'm unpacking, I'm thinking about shame, and I'm thinking about denial and addiction and the things that hold our communities back from moving forward, from our eyes on that prize. And so I become interested in the radical, and radical in its root word, meaning, you know, the roots, radical at the root and examining the root. And so for me, a piece like Remember Noah is about examining a root, like what is my first story of shame or of denial or of power that I can think of. When did I learn that? You know, and I remembered that I learned it, you know, from this biblical tale of the flood. And just really wanting to reflect on that and queer the legend and jazz the legend and interrupt the narrative and sort of like, you know, change the point of view, re-examine that hero, Noah, and just imagine the underdog in that situation, really, who are all those people that died in the flood because they were in denial. What were they doing? You know, were they like me? What color were they? Were they, you know, what was Noah's mental health like, right? To sort of unpack that story helps me to understand, the stuff I carry that may be holding me back or the stuff I carry that I can take with me into the future. So I am interested in turning back in sort of a, you know, in that Lot's wife way, Lot's wife looking back. What did she look back on? You know, we're sort of told that this is another biblical story of Sodom and Gomorrah, you know, another story of shame, I think, and shaming. And we're just told that Lot's wife looks back and turns into a pillar of salt. That haunted me. I mean, ever since I was a little girl and I learned this, what did she look back on, you know? What was back there? And I made a decision at some point, well, maybe she had a lover. Maybe her lover was a woman. Maybe she didn't want to leave with her patriarchal nuclear family just then, you know? Maybe she had to look back at that love that she was leaving behind on her way to the promised land, on that way to this momentum revolutionary place, that other place that she was being driven to. If we just sort of blindly move forward without knowing our history, without knowing what has kept us in the place that we are, if we just charge ahead, what are we leaving behind, right? So that interests me. History interests me, and its place in the present and its place in the future. And remixing all of it, you know.
Yeah. Sangu?
I like to play with the what people think is impossible. You know what I'm saying? Because when people say revolution, they think two things in general. In general. One, an actual physical race war. So we go, when revolution comes, I'm a blank, blank, blank. And don't wait till the revolution comes. You're going to see. You're going to see. And then there is the esoteric revolution that exists here. And then I often think that I know a lot of people, this panel included, who really have a firm grasp on what the problem is. And I always ask myself, so what you going to do about it, Nsangou? What behavior is going to change in you? Now that you know all this, what you going to do, right? So after discovering my ancestry, going to Cameroon, getting named, all of that, I realized that, hey, Africa's an option. It's not a magic bullet, but it's not off the table. We think it is because of all the things that are placed on it. Africans don't want us. They don't know this. We don't know that, blah, blah, blah. Colonialism, blah, blah, blah. At the same time, my experience there, I've been twice, and I'm going back again. And my experience here with Cameroonians and people from the diaspora has been uniquely beautiful. And I don't think it's just relegated to me. So whereas I think the past and the present have been covered, I'm interested in the future. What you gonna do now? Now that we know all this stuff, what you gonna actually do? And so I wanna write a play that posits one option, right? So if I'm in a sandbox playing with some kids and all the kids are pushing me out the sandbox, why the hell am I trying to fight to be accepted to stay in the sandbox? There's another sandbox that wants me. That I would have much more success, health. A lot of these things can be interconnected in getting rid of that huge racism, white supremacy thing that lives on all of us. One less thing to worry about. It's not perfect, but I think that there's a lot of things we think we can't do. We think we can't defend ourselves against police. You can, but I think that there's some trauma that makes us go, mm-mm, don't do that. We could fight back, but there's some trauma that makes us go, mm-mm, don't do that. But if I took your son and started whooping your son's ass, you come stop me real quick, wouldn't you?
Yes.
Right. Right. And I'm saying we don't have to take the whoopings. We don't have to take it. So let me pose what we think is impossible. And even if that's uncomfortable, let's sit and rock with it for a second. And let's just see if maybe it's only impossible up here. Every spiritual person, I'll end with this, every spiritual, particularly the New Age, the secret and law of manifestation says, before you can do it, you have to first see it. So let me, given everything that's been said up here, create a vision. Maybe if I can use theater to simulate a possibility, we'll consider it. And then maybe, I'm not saying it's right or wrong, I'm saying consider it. And then we can move forward about what we're going to do next so that we don't keep repeating cycles. That's what I'm trying to do. And, you know, I don't think always about revolution as much as I think about I don't want to live in pain anymore. I want to do something about it.
Wow, okay. I mean, what's interesting for me is, like, you know, with you, when you think about, when I think about revolution, I think about the Haitian revolution or the Cuban revolution, right? So the Haitian revolution, right? So, you know, that was slaves in an uprising, and they burned, I think it was over 180 sugar plantations. And it was a very specific reason and mission and agenda. It wasn't just slaves uprising because they did not like being slaves. It was like, we are aware of our servitude and how it functions, and we're gonna shut it down the way you're using us, right?
or even the Cuban Revolution. I think, you know, Castro was trying to dethrone, I forget the name of the dictator, I think it was Batista, right? So he spent, 7 years organizing armies, and they jailed him, and then he went to Mexico and found more people and brought them back, or whatever that sort of trajectory was, but stayed very, very specific about wanting to dethrone this person who had become a dictator. And so I guess I want to ask you guys, revolution looked a very specific way at one time, and the way we're discussing it now, it has all these different variables and components and tools and interconnectivity, and is it possible for revolution today to look like it did 100 years ago, 200 years ago, or even 60 or 40 years ago, and still function and still be useful? Do you guys hear that question? I know the mic is away from my mouth. But.
It would be stunning and terrifying to see the Haitian Revolution happen again. I mean, I say that because I'm Haitian American. I think about the Haitian Revolution on a regular basis. I think about inheriting that will to live and that will to be free and my responsibility as a daughter of Haiti, right? How do I carry that bloody will to live? You know, the circumstances in Haiti and Haiti were such that slaves that were being brought to Hispaniola, Saint-Domingue, were dying within years, you know, because they were being worked that hard. It was just a reality that people were dropping like flies because of how aggressively they were being enslaved, and the quality of life was just shit. It was just a nightmare. People were dying all around each other. Those circumstances are, I mean, I can't imagine something more urgent than that, right? Than, you know, you meet somebody and they die within years. There was a great outnumbering of whites in that area, right? So the slaves outnumbered their captors. The arrogance of that, I mean, can you imagine thinking, you know, somebody thinking they're so powerful that they can actually outnumber themselves and still maintain power? It's a stunning moment of arrogance in history. And so that you know, the fact that there was not a minority of people revolting on that island, that the people who were revolting were the majority. They had the numbers, they had the desperation. And the quality of that revolution is so violent, it's so brutal, it's so clear. The concept that was spreading was simply that if there is anybody white here, they will continue and uphold slavery. And so we need to decimate the white population here. We need to get up, like uproot whiteness, period. And no sort of negotiation around that. I mean, people tried. Toussaint Louverture tried to be, you know, he tried to negotiate a way for his slave captors to kind of survive out of that situation. People ran away, they moved to New Orleans and, you know, survived. But that desperation, that urgency, the blood everywhere, I mean, really imagine that. I mean, we can sort of glorify the Haitian Revolution, but to really actually imagine that nightmare of a situation where you really literally feel that you have to kill or be killed.
And didn't that prompt the French government to abolish slavery in all French colonies?
Yes, I believe so. I mean, well, what's interesting in the time period is that France is having its own revolution, right? I mean, the guillotine is going down. You know, the poor people of France are revolting. And that news is traveling to the enslaved Haitians, right? They're hearing about, you know, liberty and fraternity and being inspired on some level to sort of rally for themselves and for their own sense of humanity. And so, I mean, all of this to say, what would that mean for us, my God, mm-hmm. right? If we were really in that situation as Americans, I mean, that's the context that we're in. We're in a much larger body of land than Haiti, right? We are much, way more integrated in our lifestyles, you know? Do we really want our revolution to look like that? I hope not. I hope that we've learned something, enough of something, to know that that's. I don't want to see people go out like that. I don't want to have to kill for my life. So then what is possible? I mean,
who do you overthrow?
Who do you overthrow? That's right. That's right. At this point, we are privileged people too. I mean, we forget as Americans that we're all carrying American privilege. That in the context of the world, we are the oppressor, right? Everything's all mixed up for us in the Western Hemisphere right now, in Western culture, whether we are, you know, people of color in it or not. So it's complicated. It's complicated for us, and it's not as, you know, black or white, literally, as it had to be in Haiti.
It's really interesting because Sango and I were having a conversation about his play during the New Black Fest at the Lark, and part of my family's from Kentucky, and we've been there since the 1780s, and in the 1830s, a group of my family actually traveled to Liberia and colonized it. And there were letters that were sent back sort of describing what Liberia looked like, and there was never any mention of the indigenous Liberian people. It was only about the house they built, or the new dress they made, or what the baby looked like. And then, you know, ultimately, you know, in my own discovery that, of course, the Liberian Revolution was mostly inspired by the Americo-Liberian, my people's, oppression of the indigenous people of Liberia. And so I sort of, Sango and I were talking about that. I just wanted you to talk a little bit more about what your idea about that is, about bringing black Americans to Africa and what that looks like or what it will not look like. You know what I mean?
Right. So my first play, Redefinition, is about me discovering and connecting to my ancestral heritage, which I think is step one, to acknowledge that I never stopped being African.
Right.
No matter what history did, I never stopped being African. But there's a cognitive knowledge, there's a cognitive connection that has to kick in. So when I look at my own behavior and distinguish which part of me is African and which aspects have been things, for instance, speaking the English language and the ability to speak it as quote-unquote properly as you can in certain circumstances, but also the knowledge, Carter G. Woodson said, we need to stop thinking about the black slang, paraphrasing, as some weird abstract thing and think of it rather as the broken down African tongue. So for instance, in Shupamun, the language of the Bamun people, who I come from, the word for grandmother is Nana, N-A-N-A, meaning it's mother twice, meaning great mother. I know a lot of people who call their grandmother Nana or Nan. They didn't just pull that out the ether. That's DNA kicking in. That's lineage. You know what I'm saying? The difference between a Liberian in that sense and what I'm proposing is a redefinition of ourselves. We often talk about the African diaspora, but we don't often, I think, viscerally feel it except in moments of extreme crisis or Kwanzaa or a parade. You know what I mean? Hey, I'm black today, you go to Dance Africa. Oh yeah, let me go to Dance Africa, listen to the drums and get fried chicken. What? You know what I'm saying? Y'all know what I'm saying. It's weird. So it's just like, I'm talking about feeling Africa every day. And knowing, not general Africa, specific. Without saying that my tribe better than your tribe, my people better than your people, but being able to see, I see you in me, for real, for real. That's why we say, yo, I see you. I see you, all right. They say the same thing in South Africa. I see you, you know? So that has to happen first so that, par my example, when I went over to Cameroon and we started talking to my people, right? They expected me to speak English. And then I said, Pasane, Lishapa, Sangu. And they said, Pasana, Tue Bamun. You know, and all of a sudden, because I spent 2 years learning the language before I went. so that I would have some cultural currency to go, listen, I'm not coming over here expecting this to be the opening scene of Hotel Rwanda or the opening scene of Coming to America. I'm not expecting that. I'm coming to learn, and because of that, there was a receptivity on both ends. And I feel like that going back is the true version of like Sankofa. We say Sankofa, it's like, mean to go back. It means to go back and get it. Get it. You gotta get it first before you can go back up in there. You know what I mean? And you can't just throw on a dashiki, start eating chebujin and say you African. You can't just walk around, you know, saying, oh, peace, hotep, da da da. You have to really understand it's a visceral thing. So your whole way of thinking has to change. I would love for it, for example, to close, if when I have kids, English is their second language. Their first or their third, their first two languages are the language that my people come from and the language that their mother comes from. And that's spoken so that they understand themselves through language, because language is a huge part, I think, of revolution. Being able to speak Haitian Creole is huge to the identity. And then understanding the Africanness within that is huge, and understanding our slangs are huge. That's huge. Because then I can affirm you, I can love you, and I can bring that love up culturally. Because when you say, what's up? I'm like, yo, what's good? I know it's Africa talking. And I'm not saying, you don't know anything. You can't even say hello. You know what I mean? That's what I'm talking about. So before we go back, let's go back within ourselves.
Okay, before, I'm gonna bring you guys into it in just about 4 minutes, so be patient. And before, Dennis, before you speak, I actually wanna ask Liza a quick question about, in your piece, Peculiar Patriot, at least the part that you read from, it seems there's a lot of awareness about what's happening within the prison complex system, right? It seems to be, the characters seem to be very aware of how things work. And I'm curious to know, is that a reflection of your own work in the system, that there are people actually, inmates who are actually aware of how the system has set them up? And if so, is there a movement to somehow eradicate that or potentially revolt against that, whatever that means? Is that question clear?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the character, the protagonist, Betsy, she actually is slowly coming into the awareness of what the prison industrial complex that she's a part of. The character Pablo, he is, street genius, you know, and he represents so many black men that I know who are not college educated, but they're very educated as to the systems that they're embroiled in. So, you know, they may not speak the king's English, and I enjoy when they mash it up. But the information that they have is very real. And during my journey, and I've taken excerpts of this play in about 35 different prisons across the country, and I always have a talk back with the incarcerated audience. And I've even done some workshops and have worked in some upstate facilities, men's maximum facilities. Brilliance, absolute brilliance. Scholars who I've learned from. When we think of the general, trope of an inmate is that, they're thugged and, fighting. And that's not what I experienced. Not to say that that does not happen and that, doesn't exist, but I met scholars, I met theologians, I met bright lights. And so that's what the play, or that character, he represents, the character Pablo, he's sort of an amalgamation of the brilliant men that I've met who are aware of what's going on. You know, now they may not be able to, you know, quote, specific statistics. But, you know, they're aware that, yeah, it's the system is rigged. I think, and even the children know the system is rigged. They may not have the language to articulate it, but they know it's rigged. That's why they're dropping out of school. That's why they're wearing their pants sagging down saying, fuck you, because they know it's rigged. They don't know how to say it, articulate it, but they know it in a very deep way. So the place is kind of giving voice to that, knowing the system is rigged.
Yeah, no, I just wanted to quickly touch on you asking about revolution and what it would look like. And I kept thinking, so basically what I kept thinking in my head is hurt people, right? And in these revolutions that we spoke about and what you brought up is, you know, they were very violent. And I think even though revolution means change, I don't think it was really a revolution. And I think what the revolution really has to look like is an emotional healing. There has to be a love revolution because we've tried, we've done the violent thing. We've done the violent thing for centuries now. And it just perpetuates itself. All it does is put somebody else in a hierarchy position, but it doesn't change. And what I'm proposing is that the revolutionary is not a hierarchy, that it's across the board. There is no better, there is no worse. And I think that starts with, you know, seeing our humanity, acknowledging our humanity, valuing ourselves in all the places that we're at, whether we're incarcerated or not. And really starting with love, because if you really look at history in terms of like dictators and people who are considered evil and all that, we kind of let them rock. People who say, hey, love everybody, that's who we crucify. People who say, love everyone, that's who we kill. I don't think that's by accident. I think there's something very deliberate. If let's kill the people who say love everybody. But you know, dictators killing their people, that's fine, we can let them rock. I think that's not by accident. So that's what I'm proposing as a revolution. It has nothing to do with the patriarchal, masculine, let's kill everybody and then we can bring about a change. It's let's look at ourselves and see our own humanity and how can we change ourselves and then hence change the world. So I just wanted to.
Can I just jump in and say something real quick about revolution? And this is just jumping off of something you said. You know, I'm a Libra, so, you know, always, you're a Libra too? Oh, right. So I had this, yes. So, you know, when you were talking about, you know, the love is revolution, you know, and not the violence, you know, as, you know, your sister in Venetian scales, I think that there are a multitude of roads to get us there. So I think that we do need some people that's ready to say, fuck this shit. You come for me, I'm gonna fuck you up. And then we need the love as well. You know, so I think that we need whether you're a farmer and you're violently against Monsanto or climate change or gender rights or mass incarceration, you know, we need people, you know, on all fronts, you know, yes, and we need, you know, the spiritual warriors behind the curtain, stirring the pots and doing the voodoo juju and all of that too. Yes. So I think that, you know, there's several roads to get us to a place where all of our humanity is honored and we all feel dignified and a part of this planet that is so plentiful. This planet is plentiful.
And it's all we have.
And it's
now.
All we have. But and it's plentiful. You know, and maybe we may be able to go other places, but other places are not gonna welcome us till we get our shit together here.
You we know? Can visit.
So, yeah. They're not gonna let us visit. No, they're not. They're saying no. They need some more evolution. You know. So I look at revolution as evolution of the spirit.
Beautiful, yes. Okay, so let's open up this conversation so you all can engage and be held responsible for the world. Yes, here.
Something that I'm noticing, and it seems like everybody is on the...
She doesn't even need nobody.
Okay. And one thing I'm noticing from all the writers is that at the base of it all, and it was the same thing I thought when you posed the question, revolution, I believe it's gonna have to be more so of the spiritual and the mental, because in a lot of things I'm finding more in writings and writing myself is that we as a people are gonna have to come to a point where we're no longer searching the love of our abusive lover. All right, once we realize that they're gonna have to heal on their own, and that is gonna take time, it's gonna take some people dying out, but once we learn to love ourselves, then they will see that change. And people who love themselves don't allow themselves to be abused upon. Mm-hmm. So then people will act out, and they will physically create a revolution because you can't hurt me because I know my worth. Mm-hmm. So, and that's something as a community that's actually a physical thing that we can try to attack. Working in school systems, with kids, and even finding it in myself sometime. There is not a love of self. People still don't see themselves as beautiful. People still don't see themselves as worth it. And when you find that worth in yourself, that's the revolution, all right? Because once you know your worth, you can't touch me. You couldn't touch me. I want to allow you to touch me. So I think that's something that could be physically attacked as a goal. Mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. Yes. Someone else, eager. This young man here. We're going to bring over a mic to you, so.
Young man.
Yeah, that's you. That's you.
I'd like to ask Liza Jessie Peterson, because I heard her presentation at the Poets Cafe of the National Rights Conference. I'd like to ask you how much vocabulary do you gain from being amongst the inmates of prisons?
How much vocabulary?
Yeah.
Well, I currently work at Rikers Island. I'm a program counselor working with adolescents ages 16 and 17.
Right.
And I cannot begin to tell you how my lexicon is off the hook. It is so rich. Wow. We were talking backstage, and I was just saying how poetry just somersaults out their mouth.
Great. Mm-hmm.
Yes, don't be bashful. This is an opportunity to actually free yourself up and be fearless.
So as we're talking about theater and revolution, right? We're at the intersection. And I know that your work goes inside of the prisons. But for the other playwrights, I want to ask, and also Keith, when we're talking about revolutionary change, and we're sitting at the intersection of theater and revolution, and we know that typically in theater in the United States, people have to purchase tickets. And capitalism is a very oppressive force that prevents many people from hearing the work that is so revolutionary. What then do you propose, or what do you do as a theater artist to make sure that people have access to this revolutionary work that you're writing?
Great question.
Oh, yes. I was hoping somebody would ask this. One of the first things that I learned about particularly theater within the African aesthetic works is that you don't need a lot to do it. And so when Diallo was killed, I was a student at Howard University. And HU, you know. And myself, this guy Jabari Exum, and Chadwick Boseman participated in a theater piece that we literally just ran up on campus and started reenacting the shots to Diallo all around the main yard. Just cause. not just cause, but just cause, rather. And so I think that one of the things that I'm particularly interested in and that I teach my students when I work with them at BAM through the Continuum Project and some other organizations, is how to build theater in immediately and just put it out in public spaces.
Yeah.
I think that's one way to do it. And I say it is the African way because Nicole Wery-Wery Liking in Cameroon has theater, but it's never written down. Mm-hmm. It comes genetically out of the people. You see also a lot of that in Theater of the Oppressed, where you teach and train people to aesthetically jump in at a moment's notice to bring a social issue up and to even have the people attempt to solve it. And I think that's one way that I'm currently doing it. But another way, along with theater and revolution, is looking at the many ways in which theater can be presented. We're all familiar with the Aristotelian arc. Does it have to be that way? No, it doesn't. But we think about, again, I'm trying to get that commission, son. I'm trying to get that production, son. So we play that. You know what I mean? Yeah. And it's a real thing, but I actually do think that there is room to play with form based upon the aesthetics we bring. And not to do it in reaction to, but to do it because I'm starting with the love for myself first. I'm starting with the love for our people first. And seeing if I can bring that forward. So maybe my theater looks cyclical. Maybe it does this as opposed to this. It still has drama, it still has conflict, it still has characters who are fighting for objectives and all of that. But maybe instead of spending 4 years learning to speak Cockney and Irish, I spend 4 years learning to do accents from the diaspora. Because that's where those are the roles I'm gonna go out for. If I can't do Toussaint Louverture if I don't have a Haitian accent. It just don't work. But all I know is I know how to do Irish. I can get cast as Irish B. I'm not going to do that. So I think those are two ways. I think three ways. Content, execution, and form are three ways we can revolutionize how we do theater going forward.
Yeah, thank you.
Also, audience development is really important.
Yep.
You know, when dealing with institutions, you know, that are generally the gatekeepers generally, don't look like us. And so I think it's really important as a playwright trying to get you know, our works to a broader audience. And then how do you, as you were saying, bring in audiences that may not be able to afford the subscriber price tickets, you know, or not even be subscribers. Audience development is one, but that's a great question because, you know, bringing a theater, particularly revolutionary theater, that really challenges or ignores the white gaze is very difficult to get greenlit. Well, let me not say difficult, but it has challenges. It's a different navigation route. The scenic route. yeah. So that's something that you know, it is I don't know, Keith. I mean, Keith has created a community of playwrights and you know, avenues where our works can be seen and heard and excerpts and, you know, so there is a community, but if we're talking about, you know, major productions and it's still very challenging to get the money,
right,
and get somebody to say, yes, we're going to put that play on Broadway or even off Broadway, you know, even some of our off Broadway, you know, houses. It's challenging. So, you know, some playwrights limp, and I understand. And then those who don't, we have the scenic route. So it's, we still struggling, girl, trying to figure that shit out.
I just want to jump into this conversation really quickly and then move it on to another topic. But what's interesting for me, because most of 99.9% of the events that the New Black Fest offers are free events. And this has been going on since 2010.
That's
beautiful. Maybe the first year we asked for suggested donations of like $10 and people dropped maybe a dollar, you know, if they had it, right? And so over these last 6 years, I've gotten funding from the Time Warner folks and more recently the Ford Foundation. But most reliably, people in the community, whenever I say I'm going to commission new work around a particular social justice issue, in the moment, people rally and they drop funds into our account, which has been awesome in places like the Segal and even the Lark. They support us. And I will speak about another theater company who's in the house tonight as well. But when it comes for me at the end of the year to actually ask people to help donate and help sustain us financially, there's crickets. And I go out of the way to explain, you know, the last 5 years, everything's been free. I even hand out free tickets to see Broadway shows. Wow. Could you give me a dollar? You know what I mean? And so it's very interesting that the same five people, and a few of them actually in this room, who donate to the New Black Fest. So I spend a lot of time begging my audiences to actually be held responsible for the very thing they come to see what we're doing to participate in, you know? And I know the National Black Theater is in the house, Jonathan McCrory, Artistic Director of National Black Theater, and it makes absolutely no sense that they also have to get on their knees and beg the community and even people outside the community for funds to sustain black theater in the city. And they're the only, I think, well, not the only, because I think Henry Street Settlement is considered black theater, but maybe not. And the Classical Theater of Harlem.
Woody knows everybody. He's still got a big. That's crazy. Yeah. You understand?
Yeah, Woody knows everybody. I think they just recently pulled funding from him. So anyway, I'm saying that I feel like people need to really understand that it takes more than just coming together and sort of rallying behind voices. And, you know, it costs me to bring into, you know what I mean? Like, so please, like, I don't know what to tell you. I don't know how to. I don't know how to. Real quick, yes.
My students and some people who work with young people may know this, often feel that theater is not for them, so they don't know about it. We was just talking in the room, I was talking to some kids at Brooklyn College who didn't know about Hamilton. And we assume that everybody knows because we know. But sometimes we don't think it's for us. And maybe part of the answer to that is with audience development, as we talk to these kids and we're bringing them theater, that it's that generation that we start to target, mm-hmm. who have some of that income that they dispose on Beats by Dre.
Right. Right.
You know what I mean? To start coming, because they know it's for them, and maybe we just gotta start to shift some minds a little bit so that they know it's for them, right. And then they'll support financially.
No, that makes a lot of sense, but I'm actually talking about the people who actually are aware that this is happening and what
right.
it is, too.
No, I hear you.
I agree, it's two-tier. It's like you also have to reach out to a new generation.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Changing topics, yes. Okay.
I think I'm good, yeah. I'm some new playwright.
We're actually recording you.
Okay, perfect. Yeah, yeah. So I'm a new playwright, and I just debuted my first production last month, and self-funded. Pretty much I gathered and galvanized and put all the resources together to make it happen, and I think I hear the struggle in the panel with as far as being able to galvanize resources, because as we talk about revolution, the only way that wars have ever been won has been gathering people and also economics, right? That's where the true power and leverage is. So I'm curious, really, to kind of stay on this topic, but to talk about specific strategies that you've learned over time that do work. I think there's a way that we can position traditional formats, but also new age formats and schemes that can kind of create this way of being able to get people, a new crowd, interested, but then also being able to rely on those traditional consumers and fans that we've had over the years. What strategies have you guys learned that do work? And then are we creating platforms like this to create a solidarity to where it's not just one playwright or one producer working to push the needle, but we have all kind of come together to do so?
The internet has changed the game. So Kickstarter, you know, putting excerpts online, you know, and creating a social media presence helps, so that your work isn't isn't isolated. So I think that's one way to not have to beg at the door of a lot of these antiquated gatekeepers.
So my journey, and I'm proud about this, and my journey has been a beautiful one for me, because the reason that I'm even on this panel, the reason that I've gotten the commissions and the productions and the pedigree from Brooklyn College is because of the Black community. When I entered into this 6 years ago, I was totally ignorant of anything theater. And I just happened to win the Samuel French with a play. And then I was like, oh, I guess I'm a theater maker now that I'm a published playwright. So then I had the opportunity, funny enough, Sandra Daly is here, to join a Black playwright writers group, Lisa was on.
That's the
Armand.
So community.
Yeah, so seeking out. And then I made sure that I was always present at everybody's, like, that's my strategy. I believe in the reciprocation of love, right? So if I'm gonna show you love, it's gonna come back to me. So I make sure that I'm at everybody's event, and not at everybody's event for my own gain. I'm at everybody's event because I want you to feel my love. And it's going to come back. Now the thing is that we look for instant gratification, and that route is not an instant gratification route. We look for the money right now. And some of us, because we have families, we have bills, we have, it's understood. But I think there's this understanding or this hope that, I have a thing, come support this thing, I'm gonna blow up. And that's just not the path. That's not, that's not reality. And I think so. And the other point I think I want to make is in terms of value. I've had the opportunity to decolonize and find the value in my work, and know that my work is valuable. And I'm not talking capitalistic. The whole field of dreams, if you build it, they will come. My strategy is the mixtape in my trunk strategy, right? If I got something hot, they gonna come get it. But I have to speak my truth. I can't do it based on what I think is hot. I can't do it based on what I think will make money. I gotta do it based on what I need to say and what I'm afraid of and what I wanna explore. So that's a nugget.
Yes, Sandra. And then I want to move on to another topic too. Yeah.
I really want to piggyback off of what Dennis is saying, is because this idea of revolution for me is when we are our true selves, when we are honoring ourselves. Mm-hmm. It always scares me sometimes when we talk about revolution. I'm always asking myself, am I Black enough to be part of the revolution? Am I whatever enough to be a part of the revolution? And I find on the stage, you guys are so powerful to me, and you are revolutionaries because you are yourselves in your work. And so I get fearful when it feels exclusive, like only certain people get in the club per se. And I feel that we all have something really valuable to mine. And when we do that, then we are revolutionaries. We are all revolutionaries in spirit, because the fight, as we all realize, it's a human fight. It's about humanity that's at stake. So as long as we are true to ourselves, then we are revolutionaries, each and every one of us. So being careful not to pick and choose, that we all have something really valuable to impart. And I love what Nsangou is saying, this idea of, I think that we are really very competitive, and we're attached to the way big white organizations are doing it. I'm a producer, and I am always producing from a very small pot. If I can't produce with the $5 I have, then I can't do it. So it can't look like what The Signature is doing. It can't look like what Playwrights Horizon is doing. And neither am I interested in it looking like that. So if it does mean pop up on the side of 14th Street and do your art, then that's what you gotta do. And you gotta be okay with, you may not be able to eat today if what you're saying is that important. Get real with that. Otherwise, go do your full-time job and go do your protest and your thing at night. And that's got to be cool. Because if you really think that it's about it looking like what everybody else is doing, and I'm really for that. Like, I push everybody to do it different. We've got to do it different. Plus, we're so beautiful and so freaking talented. Like, let's do it different. Create a new way of form, a new way of giving the message, a new arena. Let's do it a different way.
And I just want to just sort of make sure people know that Sandra Daly and Brian Glover are both producers of the Obie Award-winning 48 Hours in Harlem, which is actually an organization that can be supported. And then Jonathan's part of it too, yes. And but also Sandra also has her own theater company called the Liberation Theater Company. I'm not sure if you know this, brother, but she also has a playwriting workshop as well. So there are actually folks out here doing things. We just need to be constantly informing, enriching, and supporting them, and not looking for it someplace else when it's actually in our faces. So anyone else have anything to add or inquire, urge, charge? Frank?
I do think there has been a change. I think the 60s or 70s were about changing structures, whether it was a political fight with violence or not, but it was something worth it. We have to fight for it. Now, I think we did enter an age where we say, well, maybe we have to make a new app, or you know, you have to be better, and you're a good person, and everything changes, which also is true, but these are two swings of the pendulum. There are other realities. One reality is that, if I understand right, the head electrician of the Metropolitan Opera makes $1.5 million a year. You know, there are inequities here on hand that are not really addressed, not by the city, I think not by cultural politics. There is a lot of money available in America. People complain, say in Europe, oh, they are self-funded, they can do what they want. But the same amount of money, in a way, is here, but it's not distributed in a way. It's not artists appear, review, say, they should get the money, they should do something. They are not really on the board. You know, I think Lincoln Center, as a big institution, has 85 board members. No one is an artist because it takes $250,000 to be a member of the board. But and even they don't make any decisions. It's a much smaller group, but they can say, I am. So I think, besides all what is very true, that, you know, to find peace, it's about, it has to be in yourself, or the love has to be in you as a person. You know, no one can give it to you. It won't be from the outside. On the other hand, still, there are structures and they have to be changed, perhaps in some kind of a movement and joining things. And I think the city of New York also is trying to change things and to have a cultural plan. I think we also have some people in the audience who are a part of this. So I do think, besides all of that, there has to be an outreach and, you know, and point out what might be missing, what's wrong, the voices need to be heard, and there has to be perhaps also innovative actions, or think that people see it, oh yeah, this is alive. People do something. You know, like in the old days when I think the Civil War movement said, oh, we're going to open a bank account for $1. We're going to just shut down, you know, the bank. And, you know, that something happened as an interference. So is there something that you think that you could be heard, or you think basically no one is really interested and nobody?
Well, I will say this. I mean, I'm very aware that there are certain institutions, like there's certain funding institutions in the country that are actually reshaping the way they think about who they fund to. I can think right now the Jerome Foundation is going through a whole new, not a whole new vision, because they've always been interested, but they've stopped to take a pause to like rethink about who really deserves funding, who's really like making noise about the way the world looks right now. I think that's very important that the Jerome Foundation is doing that. The Ford Foundation is also reconsidering, restructuring, getting even deeper into the importance of the other, whatever that means or what it used to mean. I mean, the marginalized voice, the voice that is centered in social justice, I think that's really exciting. Roberta Uno, who came out of the Ford Foundation, has started her own organization, which I think it's called Art Us. Art Changes, thank you, Hallie. Art Changes, which is also very much about strategizing around social justice organizations. So I think there is a movement happening, which is really important. I think that we all need to be engaged in these organizations and find out more about them and then show our interest. And also feel like there needs to be more restructuring and creative leadership. I was on a panel a couple of years ago. We were talking about Hollywood and TV and film, and how, you know, you go into some of these meetings in Hollywood and Los Angeles, and 99.9% of the people you're pitching to are white people, and you're pitching them story about blackness or queerness or Latino-ness, and they're just sort of like, okay, no or yes. And I think that's unfair, and there needs to be more diversity in creative decision making. And I think that also means that we need more people in graduate programs or who are just eager to be a part of that world, as opposed to just creating the art, creating the content, but also interested in puncturing into the creative leadership. And I think that's also happening a little bit more. But we just need more people really thinking about those strategies as opposed to falling into them by chance. But really, like, this is what I'm setting out to do. I'm setting out to run a theater company with these people involved, and this is our mission, and blah, 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 as opposed to looking for it in other places to making it happen themselves. I don't know if that answers your query, but...
Yeah, I'm also interested in how we can make those spaces uncomfortable. you know, because I think often, you know, when you're the only one in the room, when you're the only person of color who's a board member on a particular institution, there's a certain, it's tense. It can get tense if you really want to sort of challenge folks. And I've, you know, knowing that I was coming here, I looked back at Amiri Baraka Leroy Jones's essay, performance essay, really The Revolutionary Theater. And I just, you know, I think about how, you know, in the 60s, in the mid 60s, he was shaking up, you know, a predominantly white room. You know, it's 1965 at the Overseas Press Club. You know, 4 days later, Malcolm X is going to be assassinated, and Leroy Jones gets up on this stage and he says, "This should be a theater of world spirit, where spirit can be shown to be the most competent force in the world. Force, spirit, feeling, the language will be anybody's, but tightened by the poet's backbone." He said, "Art is method." He said, "We are history and desire." He said, "Possibility is what moves us." He's saying this stuff in 65. I mean, the context is super hostile. And you know, you can actually listen to this moment. WNYC has a recording of this appearance, and it follows with a talkback. You know, a discussion similar to like this. But the room doesn't look like this when he's the audience that he's speaking to is predominantly white, again, a privileged press club sort of group of people. And they're, I mean, they're calling him, you know, a person who's full of hate. They're, you know, they're charging him with all sorts of, you know, you are the devil incarnate, basically. And I think of him, I think of Leroy Jones, I think of Amiri Baraka sitting there in that moment, just solid in his being and his perspective and the philosophy that he's building, and just speaking what he believes to be the truth at that time. I mean, when you look back at that essay, there are parts of it that I'm like, yeah, right on. And there are parts of it I'm like, I don't know. I don't know about this, my brother, right? But he was willing to risk, you know, what was then what was about to be popularity because of the Dutchman doing so well, right, in the New York theater scene. He was risking that, willing to put it on the line for being the only one in the room who's gonna just tell it like he thinks it needs to be told. So it's scary, and I think it is about sort of our own discomfort sometimes in these spaces. And really, you know, it's hard. It's, I mean, you know, you need support groups, you need the New Black Fest, you know, to come home to, you know, after you're in those spaces. But I do think there is a responsibility, right, to walk into that room and to know why you're there. Yes, yeah. Or to be afraid and to say so, you know, fearlessly.
No, I just, you said fearless, and I thought about, you made me think about the bravery, right? And in the context of bravery, usually it's something, it's usually you're willing to put your life on the line for something. We say they're brave. Or we say someone's brave when they're willing to share a very vulnerable, a very honest happening to them. So for example, when I shared what happened to my mother, the reason I can share it is because she's very open about being abused, because it's about who she is, it's her history, it's what's made her who she is. And that bravery, and the reason it's considered bravery is because usually we shame people for that, mm-hmm. right? And shame is the master manipulator. right? It's always shame. When people want to manipulate you, they're going to use shame to make you do something. So what I, when I'm thinking about bravery and I'm thinking about us going out as we go out into the world and decide to share this and everybody out there in internet land, I'm really interested in us exploring our shame and what we're ashamed of, and being brave enough to speak that, because once you speak it, it can no longer control you. And I think that's important in this work, in this theater, particularly in the Black community. We are shamed, we have been shamed for over 390, 400 years, just for the color of our skin, right? And we've internalized that. So it's time to let go of that shame so there can be a revolution. So,
Liza and Sangu, could you also, I mean, I consider that sort of your final word. So if you both could give us a final word about this evening for you, what revolutionary means to you, or you want to share with us, like 30 seconds. In 30 seconds.
Create a community. Like, I love what you've done, you know, and I've recently, not recently, but through the past several years, have been finding community where my voice is heard and appreciated and valued. So I think, you know, these communities, and you know, Jonathan has a community, and you have a community, and Sandra has created a community, and so there's other communities that are an antidote to the old way, these old gatekeepers. So for me, that's revolution. Community is revolution, because we're finding each other, we're loving each other, we're listening to each other, we're creating with each other, we're producing with each other, and then you have people go, oh, what are they doing over there? And then, like you said, then they begin to come. You know, you said build it, and then somebody said they'll build it and they'll come. Somebody said that. You said that. Yeah, okay. Right, so yeah. I heard it, right. But yeah, so I think that to me is revolution.
Me? 30 seconds. And you could do it. You could.
Yeah. I will go back to what the monologue said at the beginning: access or freedom. Access or freedom. I'm gonna say this for me. I know I have been in places recently that have given me access. At the same time I was in those spaces, I was rocking with you. I was all up in here, either in the audience or on stage. And no matter how much access I receive, I'm rocking with y'all. Now, that's not true for everybody else, because when they get access, it's like based in this space means peace, see you later. Yeah, that'll sink in for the hip hop heads. But I think I had to take a serious look at that. I had to take a serious look at what that means when I become successful. A serious look at what it means to be revolutionary, and a serious look at what it means to be free. If I can't define that, I don't have any business up here. And if I can't enact that after I drop this microphone and we go off and talk, I shouldn't have been up here in the first place. So my prayer is that we walk out of here and take some action and say that what we create as theater artists is true and different in form, true and different in content, true and different in message, and that we always gaze through our own eyes or the eyes of those whose shoulders we stand on. And everybody else who comes to watch can watch. If you don't get it, sometimes I don't get Shakespeare. Why are you talking like that? I gotta spend 10 minutes. Now you have to spend 10 minutes with my Bamun people. And ultimately, that healing and that accountability and that balance will come. But today, when I put this mic down and I go back to the computer to write, or I go to the journal to write, I'm thinking of you all. And how can we be mentally, psychologically, spiritually, emotionally, and physically free? So if my play makes you go, get your hands off me, cop. You know you ain't touching me. Okay, do something, see what happens. Watch my people line up. Now what you gonna do? If that happens, I was a revolutionary. And if we all hug each other and say what's up and can appreciate each other through something I wrote or something y'all wrote, that's revolution. And if those two things happen together, that damn sure is a revolution. That's what it means to me.
Keith, can I just one thing quickly? Yes. I'm thinking, just listening to Nsangou speak, about how amazing it is that we write, because our people who were brought here were not taught how to read and write. And you know, I'm gonna go home and I'm gonna write, and that's one of the ways that I'll be thinking of you. It is a revolutionary act to be a Black writer. It is an amazing, amazing, amazing inheritance, right? Our people had the will to live, and so we are writers. And that's a great responsibility and joy.
Yeah. All right, thank you. I want to thank everyone for showing up tonight and participating in this amazing conversation around revolutionary writing. I want to thank the Segal Theater and all the people involved in making this happen. Rebecca, everybody, I just can't mention everybody's name right now, but we thank you very, very much. We're actually having a post-reception with wine. Okay, so please. So please, yeah. So please stay for that. Again, thank you very much.